Hey, I'm Philip Pilkington. I've bought myself a new camera. It's the Nikon Z6. I'm going to do a short video just to explain why I bought it and the good points about it. Maybe only a few bad points, but watch this video just to see what I think. And if it's worthwhile, then maybe it's an option for you. But here's the video just to explain a bit more about it. So the things that convinced me to buy this camera was that I already have Nikon equipment, got a lot of Nikon lenses. I've come from Nikon D600 and a Nikon D7200. I have both those cameras. It is basically for me, I think, a time for an upgrade. But the thing that tempted me for this camera is the video capabilities. I still think my Nikon D600 and D7200 both good options for stills, nothing wrong with them in that area. I am expecting a bit better stills with this camera. Some of the things that it's got that I wanted is the backside illuminated sensor. So I think that's going to give me better performance in low light. But the video capabilities are really strong. So some of the capabilities are the fact that it can do 4K video, the fact that it's got, if you do use an external recorder, you can record in a format which is N-log, so you can grade the shots, just make more changes without losing quality. The fact that it's got focus peaking, the fact that you can do slow motion video, 120 frames a second, that's in HD, but the quality is good. I'm quite happy with that. The fact that the 4K is downsampled from 6K, it's from the results I've been testing with, it's really, really good quality. Some of the other features that I wanted is the fact that the sensor has stabilisation. There's an extra stabilisation for video, but it does crop the frame quite a lot. So just be prepared for that. If you want that extra stabilisation, you will end up with a heavily cropped image. I've got some Tamron lenses, and I've also got some Nikon lenses. So when it comes to compatibility, my Tamron 15 to 30mm f2.8 works fine, there's no issues. My Tamron 24 to 70mm f2.8 G2 lens is not compatible. It can be made compatible, but it does mean sending it away to get it calibrized or to buy equipment to calibrize it yourself. No, I don't really want to do any of those options, but in the future I may get it sent away, but I haven't done it yet. So that is an issue for me, but the benefits of the camera are worth it, and I still think it's a very, very good choice. One thing that I found particularly interesting is using the old manual focus lenses with focus peaking. So this camera is my very first camera, which is a Nikon FE2. I mean, really old, but really cool. Comes with, well, the lens that I've got on it is the 50mm f1.4. And I've got some sample images to show you now of what it's like shooting with that lens on this camera. And I'm comparing it to this lens, which is the 50mm f1.8G lens. So I'm going to show you those images side by side to let you see what you think of it. I've also compared images from the Z6 to the Nikon D600. Kept the settings exactly the same. I actually shot on F2 just to make it an even comparison, because what I want is image quality. I'm not comparing, you know, an F1.4 to F1.8, but the in the results, I think you'll see that I prefer the sharper, better colour that you get, maybe more contrasty shots that you get from the f1.8G lens compared to the old f1.4 manual lens, but it was really good to be able to focus with the peaking on the manual lens. So I've got some video as well to show you, because I shot with the old 50mm lens, and the result's really good. I mean, I think the strong point is probably the bokeh. It's really soft, buttery, creamy sort of looking bokeh. It isn't very sharp though. That is the downside to these old lenses. Not very sharp, but they look good, and you've just got to be prepared for the trade-off with that. But yeah, it's just a really good option to be able to focus in that way with those old manual lenses, or even the new manual ones. I don't have new manual focus lenses, but it really does become more of an option to be able to like consider a Zeiss lens with the focus peaking. One example I wanted to show you is the settings that I have when it comes to video is I usually go for highest option on quality, shoot at say 24 frames per second most of the time, unless I want it slow-mo. The ISO that I go for is auto ISO, and I wanted to show you how that works, or how it looks when you're actually filming and you're going from a light area into a dark area. Because it's really quite a nice sort of smooth transition, and I feel quite sort of safe in that it's going to do a good job. So that's why I usually leave it in that mode. One of the other reasons why I went for the Z6 is the autofocus tracking, or the face detection. I actually think it works quite well. I'm really happy with it. And from what I hear, there's going to be updates to this. So it's going to have the eye tracking, which is comparable to the Sony's. I also hear that Sony's are also getting an update, which will make theirs even better. But, I'm happy with the face tracking as it is. Eye tracking sounds like it will be better, but I don't have a problem with that. One of the things that I heard about this camera before buying is how good the electronic viewfinder is. Now, I've never even touched another mirrorless camera, so I don't know what the other ones are like. Now, I don't think it's particularly strong in this, and this one's meant to be the best. So I'd hate to think what the other mirrorless camera EVFs are like. I'd say it's okay, but it's not very strong, but apparently it's like the best on the market for that. Another point, which is one of the not so good points about the camera, is the lag when you are shooting stills. I was shooting in silent mode, which is great. I mean, I've never had silent mode before, which is actually really useful. But you press the shutter and then you wait, and then it will go black, and then you'll be ready to shoot again. But It seems to take too long. So if you are, I can imagine it in a wedding scenario or an event scenario. If you really want that really snappy, just as soon as you've taken a shot, it's ready for the next shot. I don't think this would be a great camera for that, but I do know it does take. It has some stats about how many frames per second it can do. I don't even do that type of photography, so I wouldn't know, and that's not for me. But I do want it to be snappier. You know, when you're just taking one frame here, one frame there, there is a bit of lag, and that is it's a bit of a downside to the otherwise great user experience. But I think that is just one of the sacrifices of going to mirrorless, because especially, you know, for Nikon, this is first generation mirrorless, so maybe there is some teething problems, but it's still very, very good camera, especially for the way I use it. It doesn't really get in the way that much, but I would like it to be quicker, that's all. Some of the other downsides that other people have talked about is the fact that it's only got one card slot. To me, that is not that much of an issue. If I was shooting weddings, if I was shooting events, it would be a problem. I've only shot a few weddings myself, but if I was shooting more weddings, I still wouldn't let it bother me that much, because I always take two cameras and have two different lenses. So if I was having my Z7, I might have my 70 to 200 on it. And if there was a problem with the card, I wouldn't lose everything. I would have my main camera with two card slots. So let's just say Nikon D600. I'd have all those shots because I'd have two cards in that camera. So it's not, you wouldn't be putting all your eggs in one basket. So you wouldn't lose out too much if you did decide to use this type of camera for a wedding, as long as you've got other types of backup. The other downside that people talk about is the battery, and I have noticed that the battery does go down quite quick, and it's a pretty simple reason, I think, which is that the rear screen is on all the time, and the fact that you're using an EVF, which is another screen, I mean, it's small, but it is just another drain on the battery. Now, one tip is to basically just keep your camera in airplane mode. That only interferes if you want to use, you know, SnapBridge, if you want to use the Wi-Fi or Bluetooth connections. But other than that, the airplane mode doesn't get away of any other features. So there's no reason why not to use airplane mode in order to save on the battery. One thing I was thinking before buying this camera is, if you do shots without using the shutter, does it add towards the shutter count? And from my experience, it actually does. You're still adding up shots on the shutter count, even if you're not using the shutter, which is a little bit disappointing, because I'd like it to not count, because then it won't add mileage or perceptive mileage to the, when it comes to selling it years down the line. It'd still be it would have a higher value if it had a low shutter count. But, you know, that was something I was willing to overlook, because I wanted this camera. One of the best things about the Nikon Z6 really is how good it feels in the hands. I've heard many people online say the same thing, but it really doesn't hit home until you've actually got it and you start using it. All the buttons, they feel very, very nice to use, really good. And just the user experience is really high level. I mean, the camera's so small compared to what I'm used to. Even though I've got the adapter, I haven't bought any of the Z mount lenses. In future, I think I will. I think I'm waiting. I'm waiting for the f/2.8 24-70mm, which I think will be a strong lens. I think I will replace the Tamron G2 that I've got with the Nikon lens. Or it's worth waiting to see what third parties are going to do with the Z mount, because I'm sure Tamron will come out with some really strong lenses. So we'll just wait for that one and see how that goes. One really big reason why I bought this camera is the ability to focus stack in the focus shift function. So it will take a series of photos for you at different focus areas, and in post-production you can build that up to make one image. Now, as a product photographer, this is valuable, really valuable bit of kit. Previously only available on the Nikon D850 in the Nikon range. It's on the Z6 as well as Z7, but the fact that it's a lower priced camera that has that function, which is quite a high end function, I feel, I was really worried that they weren't going to include that, but the fact that they did, I think it's great. It's great for me, because the quality difference is massive. If you want to do a product shot and you want it all in focus and you shoot on f/22, your image isn't going to be very sharp. so it's going to lack quality. And when you're dealing with a lens like I've got a Nikon f4 70-200, the sharpest point of that lens is f4. So if you want the best quality image, then you need to do a lot of focus stack images, and with that lens it could be 20 or 30 images stacked to make one really good high quality image. But this camera can do it, and it can really help with that. So it's so valuable to have that feature for me. So that was one big factor, having that capability. All right, guys, I hope you found this information useful, and I'm going to be doing more videos about the Nikon Z6. So it's going to be a bit of a sort of user's manual type series of videos. So just keep an eye out, and thanks for watching. But if you want to see more of my work, please visit my website. So that's philippilkington.com, and also look at my Instagram accounts, such as Philip Pilkington. And it's the same for my Facebook account, which is also my name, Philip Pilkington. So thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.